I think what every person on Earth thought until the mid-19th century, actually.
Right, but the...
Brett managed to sink to new lows by essentially engaging in a variation of polio vaccine denialism. The focus on this one is that there's a person advocating an alternative origin for polio. It's related to pesticides, Matt. You know, the modern world things are, yeah. It's so very in line with Brett. So, you know, just as usual, he's promoting absolute dross and anti-vax stuff. But the other aspect is, and we'll get into the stimulus for this, but Brett, in response to some comments by Tucker, started to make tweets about evolution. Now, this is never a good idea for Brett because, you know, he likes to tweet in a very obfuscatory, is that a word?
Yep, that's correct.
Yeah, yes. And fucking hell. He likes to be opaque in his tweets. When he tweets about evolution, he does this too, right? So he said, I'm a biologist. It is my job to figure out what's wrong with our evolutionary framework. Darwin understood this and highlighted all the things that worried him about his own hypothesis. His work has survived and is now a proper, if incomplete, theory of biological diversity. Darwinists have become so defensive in response to creationism that most can't now respond to high-quality challenges. They focus instead on minutiae and ignore major paradoxes. Insistences that Darwinism is settled has derailed serious attempts to repair and complete the model.
That is his obfuscatory style. I noticed this with all of his tweets. When he's got a hot take on one of these issues, he frames it in such a way that it is very unclear that is what he's saying. The only thing that's clear is that he knows an awful lot about evolution, and whatever you think you know about it is wrong. It's impossible to engage with because it's like dealing with a cloud of mist.
Yeah, and when he does get to it, it's essentially arguing his silly intelligent design like lineage theory stuff, right? Or his pseudoscience around telomeres or whatever. Like, it's all linked into his conspiratorial narratives or his very, very poorly fleshed out alternative evolutionary theories, which are not based on like empirical research or theoretical papers, just based on Brett, like, you know, thinking about it and deciding that the normal processes of evolution, which have been updated quite a bit since Darwin published On the Origin of Species, are like not sufficient. So we need explorer modes, which is one of his other, you know, alternative evolutionary perspectives. And they all amount to injecting a theological overriding kind of metaphysical substrate to evolution through which there's kind of a will of evolution. And Brett tries to deny that that's what he's implying, but that is what he's implying, as we've seen time and time again when we've actually looked at his statements about evolution.
Yeah, but even if his bespoke theory was quite reasonable, I think your first point is the most important one, is that it has come from him sitting in an armchair and freewheeling and him deciding that this is the correct way to do it. But he knows enough of the lingo, enough of the language, and is obfuscatory enough to be able to sort of allude to or hint at all of these deep understandings that you don't understand when there's just nothing behind it at all. It's effective. It's effective for people.
It is effective. But the one interesting thing is that it's created a little bit of a division in the guru sphere, because what started this all off is Tucker Carlson and his comments on evolution on Joe Rogan. So let me just play this because it's an illustration of Tucker Carlson, you know, his worldview and also the general standard of thought that you hear on Joe Rogan. So this is what Tucker said.
If evolution is real and if there is this
is
constant, I don't know, but it's visible. Like, you can measure it in certain animals.
You can measure adaptation.
Yeah.
But there's no evidence that evolution... In fact, I think we've kind of given up on the idea of evolution. The theory of evolution as articulated by Darwin is, like, kind of not true.
Right? In what sense?
Well, in the most basic sense, the idea that, you know, all life emerged from a single cell organism and over time, and there would be a fossil record of that, and there's not. And
there's not a fossil record of transitionary species, like species that are adapting to its environment.
There's tons of record of adaptation, and you see it in your own life. I mean, I have a lot of dogs. I see adaptation in dogs, you know, through the...
Sure.
Litter to litter. But no, there's no evidence at all that, none, zero, that, you know, people, you know, evolve seamlessly from a single cell amoeba. No, there's not. There's not. There's no chain in the fossil record of that at all. And that's why you don't actually hear people, you hear them make reference to evolution, because the theory of adaptation is clearly, obviously true. But Darwin's theory's totally, that's why it's still a theory almost 200 years later, you know. We have not found that at all. And I can't even guess. I mean, I have my own theories on it, but they're not proven.
What are your theories?
God created people, you know, distinctly, and animals. I mean, I think that's like, I think what every person on Earth thought until the mid-19th century.
So there you go. That's a blast from the past. I remember the great evolution creationist debates when that was an exciting and hot thing online. Now, Tucker Carlson basically towing the line from 20 or 30 years ago pretty straightforwardly, right?
Yeah, very old school creationism and like... And absolutely brain dead. There's massive amounts of evidence, fossil evidence, but also genetic, molecular evidence. There's so many you know, intersecting lines of evidence that his statement that we don't have any, it's just absolute bullshit.
It's like, absolute Tucker's bollocks. Yeah. Bullshit. Like, but yeah, I mean, and, you know, like he's hitting some of those great, you know, I say great, but well-known, stupid creationist talking points, right? Oh, there's gaps in the fossil record. It's just a theory, as implying that a theory is just like a guess, you know, and you know, really dumb stuff. One thing I hadn't heard before is, oh, there's like a theory of adaptation, and that's very distinct from a theory of evolution.
Oh, I've heard that. That's and macro evolution.
That's what he's referring to. That's what he's referring to, right? So this
like dogs can become different species, but a dog cannot become a beaver, right? That's the way they usually phrase it. That was that bit. And also the point about like, you know, there's no evidence of single cell evolution up to humans, right? Because like single cells don't fossilize. Right.
Yeah.
You know,
six billion years is a long time. You know, we unfortunately, so there is, you know, gaps, so to speak. Of course, there is. There can't help but be gaps, right? When you're talking about 6 billion years ago. But
what's going to fossilize when you don't have freaking skeletons? Right. Yeah. Like, you know, and even then, we do actually have imprints of, you know, soft bodied creatures and whatnot as well. Mm. But like, you're not going to have the evidence of microscopic life back to the, you know, over millions of years. So
we don't need to litigate it. There's no one listening who's stupid enough to give credence to these sorts of arguments. If there is, sorry to be mean, use this as an instigation to go read some books on evolution, because it keeps updating all the time. Like, they keep finding new evidence, and it's an absolutely fascinating story, especially for me, the early, you know, when they keep finding, as you say, these sort of pseudo-fossils, I suppose, like actual traces of, you know, not single-celled organisms, but just some of the very early multicellular organisms in the Permian, is it? Anyway, fascinating.
Yeah, it's stupid old-school creationism, but also you hear Joe Rogan, his kind of reaction, which is not, like, he didn't endorse everything that Tucker was saying. But Tucker says, well, evolution, I'm pretty sure, you know, is that real? And Joe's like, I don't know, you know. He's just a very credulous soul. And then the point about it just being a theory, right? Evolution just being a theory, a very, very common talking point, which misunderstands the scientific use of the word theory. This is very stuff that is known, stuff that is very common and easily rebutted. But it just goes to show there's two options. Tucker is either pandering, right? Saying things which he knows to be false in order to pander to an audience or some, you know, the conservative Christian ideology, or he's an absolute moron. It's one of the two. Both are shit. It could well be a mixture of both. And the funny thing for me is that I have heard sensible people, relatively sensible people before tell me whenever Tucker was doing this anti-woke monologues that actually, you know, Tucker is quite an insightful guy. Like, yeah, there's stuff that he gets wrong, but actually he's quite smart. And like, I don't think so. I don't think so, because since he's came out of, and at the time I also said that in response to those claims, but like, since he's come out of the Fox ecosystem, the amazing thing is that it's been revealed that Fox was actually restraining his idiocy, right? Like, he's become more conspiratorial, more endorsing of idiotic conspiracies like, you know, Obama's, the gay prostitute who claims they've slept with Obama, aliens, just like every brand of pseudoscience and conspiracy theory, Tucker is in on them. And whether it's marketing or personal belief, it doesn't matter. Like, he's a moron.
He is a moron, or a liar, or both, as you say. And it is illustrative that Brett feels compelled to kind of defend Tucker. He can't endorse the creationism because he thinks of himself as an evolutionary biologist.
As Bad Stats put it, his superpower is claiming evolutionary insights, right? So he can't dismiss evolution.
But in a very Brett style, he doesn't blame Tucker. He blames Tucker's skepticism of evolution on the academy, on the evolutionary biologists who have destroyed people's trust in institutions and so on. So
this leads to the point that I wanted to make, that, you know, the heterodox sphere, such as it is, there are divisions in it, and there are people with varying degrees of like scientific or alleged scientific principles, right? And Jeffrey Miller was tweeting out about true or false, conservatives who don't understand evolution by natural selection are an embarrassment to conservatism, right? So a kind of dig at Tucker. In response to this, Scott Adams responded, science doesn't believe in natural selection. That part of the theory was replaced years ago. So interesting news, right, for evolutionary biologists there. Natural selection, that's been completely refuted. And you can imagine that he's going to be talking about, he'll invoke something that he's vaguely heard about, horizontal gene transfer, epigenetics. Yeah. Like, they all do this.
And this is where the role that someone like Brett plays is very useful to these cretins, because by obfuscating and making it sound like it's all so complicated and we just don't know and we're completely revising what we thought about it, it just creates this great big ambiguous vacuum for people to insert whatever random beliefs that they want to. And that's the role that Brett plays in that ecosystem. But Chris, Tucker said a lot of other crazy things with Joe.
He did. But before I get to the mat, there's one more example of that interaction that I wanted to mention, because, you know, Colin Wright, he's become like kind of fixated on trans issues and gender stuff. He retweeted Brett and said, can you provide a link to what you believe is the highest quality challenge to Darwinism that also outlines some of the major paradoxes you were alluding to? I've asked for this before and have been left empty-handed. I'm not trying to troll you. I'm genuinely very curious. So this is a heterodox person that it's harder for Brett to ignore, right? And he responds, I'm not challenging Darwinism. To my way of thinking, I believe in it more coherently than our colleagues who defend the current version as if it wasn't crude. To be perfectly blunt, I think Darwin had it right because he didn't have the tools to be specific about the molecular dynamics. That forced him to work at the phenomenological level, and he got it mostly right in a manner that I believe will prove to be timeless. The central dogma is blinding us to the larger Darwinian truth. So it is what you said, you know, Brett's smokescreen, and it's him wanting to say that the specific mechanisms, because he's talking about like processes of like protein evolution, which he doesn't think apply to it. But Colin Wright's response, there are very interesting beginnings of thoughts here, but again, I would really love it if you fleshed them out in as much rigorous detail as possible so that I and others can see the supposed icebergs you're alluding to beneath those interesting tips. So it's just this thing where the guru, like, yes, Colin Wright is kind of challenging and hinting, right, that he's skeptical about Brett's claims and that Brett hasn't published anything about it. But they also have to say, well, this is a, you know, a fascinating idea that you've put forward. There is a lot of intriguing things there. So, you know, I'd love to see more. And just, I fucking hate it, Matt. The Gurus just, it just illustrates that the amount of pseudoscience that flops around and that they occasionally bump into how okay that various other gurus are with pseudoscience. Yeah. And when it's their particular brand of science, they are a bit more defensive about. They're kind of like, oh, wait, are you guys all actually like cranks? You know, they're, yeah, but you know, the Gurusphere politeness prevails in many respects. So it was just an interesting bunch of Gurusphere's colliding in the night.
Yeah, it is interesting. What Brett cannot do is point Colin Wright to some literature, some actual hard writing that actually spells out these supposed fundamental challenges, because there isn't any. There's just Brett's armchair thoughts. But for some reason, everybody treats them, not everyone, but people like Colin feel obliged to treat them seriously.
That is what it is. But as you mentioned, Matt, there are other things in Joe Rogan and Tucker's conversation which highlight their general credulous nature and some of the biases that we've talked about. So one just quick clip. I've said before that Joe Rogan intentionally sought to rehabilitate Alex Jones's profile, right, to kind of restore his credibility in the eyes of his audience after the Sandy Hook events. And here he is explaining that to Tucker again.
And when you hear Alex Jones talk, you may not agree with everything he says. I don't know that I do. But you definitely understand why they told you you couldn't listen to Alex Jones.
Well, that's one of the reasons why I had him as one of the first guests when I came over to Spotify.
Love that.
I was like, let's go.
What did they say?
Well, a lot of people weren't happy. We lost sponsors. It was an issue. But I think it did the job.
Did the job.
Yeah, he may not agree with everything that Alex says.
Yeah, well, they say that, Matt, you know, strategic disclaimers are useful things. Let's hear a little bit more about their opinions about Alex.
Regardless of what he said that's incorrect, clearly the Sandy Hook thing was incorrect. You know, Alex, I know Alex personally, so I know what he was going through. And, you know, everybody wants to talk about mental health and they want to praise people for being honest about their mental health issues and support them on their mental health journey to wellness. Alex has gone through some real issues, and one of the reasons why he's gone through some issues is because that guy is uncovering real shit that's terrifying every fucking day, and he was drinking out of control, and, you know, he's just fucking constantly stressed, freaking out, and when you see so many lies and so much propaganda and so many psyops that are being done on people, you start seeing them where they don't exist, and that's what he did.
Well, and he's also channeling some stuff. You can't call 9/11 in detail because you're super informed. He called it.
Yes.
He literally called it in the summer of 2001. He said planes will fly into the World Trade Centers and they will blame a man called Osama bin Laden. We know that he said that because he said it on tape multiple times. And then he said, call the White House and tell them this.
Joe will always hand wave the Sandy Hook as that was Alex's mistake, you know, like he did get that one wrong. But Matt, it's only because of how right he is on so many things and like how much damage his understanding about like real psyops and real conspiracies has been to him. Like in a way, he's kind of a martyr, sacrificing his mental health to, you know, dig out all these truth. And that's Joe on this occasion and many others points out that, sure, Alex gets, you know, things wrong, but he gets so many things right, Matt. You know, he predicted 9/11. He's got like insights that normal people don't have. And just to hammer that home,
I've asked him about it. How did you do that? At length, he had dinner in my barn recently. We're talking about this. How'd you do that? I don't know. It just came to me. And that's real. That is real. The supernatural is real. And I don't know why it's so hard for the modern mind, I guess because it's a materialist mind, to accept that. But what you see, and that's not a new phenomenon. It's happened throughout history. There are people called prophets. And there are people who were prophets who weren't called prophets. But there are people who have information or parts of information, bits of information, visions of information come to them, and then they relay it. It's not from them. They received it. this is like the, you know, one of the oldest phenomena in human history. So those people tend to be a little crazy, a little imbalanced, a little different from everybody else. Do you know what I mean? They live on locusts and honey in the wilderness. I mean, that's just like, they're not like everybody else. And that's clearly part of what, I'm not saying that everything that Alex Jones says is a prophecy from God. It's not. But that was prophetic.
Right. So Alex Jones doesn't just have some interesting ideas. He's not just right about a lot of things. He's literally, in the non-metaphorical sense, a prophet. Who can see things, like see the future.
Which is what Alex seems, right?
Is it?
and he didn't, by the way, he talked about a terrorist attack and bin Laden being involved. He didn't predict, you know, the Twin Towers, the planes and all that kind of thing. It's just revisionist history. Alex does it as well. And he's predicted thousands and thousands of other things that, you know, did not occur. But he, even in the case where he did correctly mention bin Laden, it was not like nobody was aware that bin Laden is a threat, right? He'd been involved in attacks previously. So yeah, just to say that even on that, it's wrong. But there, Tucker and Joe goes on to, you know, kind of endorse this as well, that Alex is really a kind of, you know, he's got these kind of extrasensory sources for his insights that he provides, which again, Matt, just transparent bullshit. Like, listen to a episode of Knowledge Fight and you will see that Alex Jones has no special powers of insight. He simply reads headlines, regurgitates whatever conspiracy theory he's come across, and promotes like a hard right populist racist worldview, right? Like a conspiracy laden militia kind of worldview. So it's quite clear Tucker's a fool. Rogan is a fool as well. But that's not the end, Matt. That's not the end. Last Tucker clip for today.
Right. I mean, the prophet Ezekiel writes about it in the first chapter, Wheels in the Sky.
Yeah, know, that's a crazy one. Boy, when you
read
it.
Well, it is crazy. If you read it, it's like, oh, wow.
Yeah.
You know, and
a wheel.
Not just, you know, the Hebrew scriptures, like it's all over every
the Vedic texts.
Of course. Mm-hmm. So these are spiritual phenomena. There's no evidence they're from another planet. I mean, I think that's the op, that's the lie, that they're from Mars. Look, space, the atmosphere is really well monitored, right? Both for military, for defense reasons, but also because, like, it'd be nice to know when asteroids are coming. And there's no evidence, has never been any evidence, that there are lots of these objects, these vehicles coming into our atmosphere from somewhere else, some other planet. There's no evidence of that at all.
Hmm.
So they're from here, and they've been here for thousands of years, whatever they are. And it's pretty clear to me that they're spiritual entities, whatever that means. They're supernatural, and which is to say, supernatural means above the natural, above the observable nature. And they don't behave according to the laws of science as measured by people, you know, and they've been here for a long time. And there's a ton of evidence they're under the ocean and under the ground. So, like, with that fact set, what do you conclude?
Supernatural entities.
With that fact set.
You said that's the last clip, so I don't think you're going to play it. But one of the other things I heard Tucker saying, and I thought he was referring to aliens, but given what he just said there, maybe not. But he was talking about how the Manhattan Project was a psyop, that they haven't really figured out how to split the atom themselves. That it seemed to be saying that it was alien technology and the Manhattan Project was a cover story. But maybe he was referring to demonic spirits who gave the Americans the technology for the bomb. I don't know.
Who knows, right? But in general, there's so little point to digging in deep to the lore that these people develop, because it's half-baked, repeated nonsense from some stupid source that they've dug out. So, I mean, there is utility to it to look at the genealogy of these ideas, right? Because you can usually trace them back to very stupid conspiratorial sources, often quite anti-Semitic sources is one of the other thing that crops up in this kind of material a lot. But it's just illustrative that, like, Tucker's into interdimensional spiritual explanations for UFOs. Evolution is just a theory. Alex Jones is a prophet. Like, how much more do you need to be discredited? And yet, Tucker is someone that people like Brett Weinstein, Joe Rogan, and Elon Musk have repeatedly promoted as a very valuable, insightful person doing, you know, really important work, looking critically at things.
Like you said, there are people who we know who are smart, who are educated, and who will give amazing credit to people like Tucker Carlson simply because they are saying things that they like to hear. And the other end of the spectrum, I've been surprised at the amount of credit that people like to give someone like Hassan Piker, who is also equally obviously an idiot. And it just goes to show how much we're governed by the stuff that we want to, you know, the stuff that we want to hear.
Well, okay, on Hassan, to his credit, I will say I don't think he's going to be endorsing ancient... I don't know. Maybe he's okay with ancient aliens and stuff, but like, he's not going to fall to the depths that Tucker has about evolution, right? So his idiocy is of a different caliber. I feel like he's slightly higher than Tucker Carlson, isn't he?
No, I mean, come on. Given what we've just heard from Tucker Carlson, I'm putting them on the same level. Sorry. Both sides.
Well, why are you putting Hassan on that level, though?
Oh, and what, you think I'm being mean to Hassan?
I mean, he's not at that level of... He's not Alex Jones level of...
No, I'm saying Tucker Carlson level.
Tucker Carlson. But Tucker Carlson is Alex Jones level to me.